Namaskaram to everybody who's here, and I know there are some old friends here also. Hello to everyone. Going to be a lot of different types of music. I start with the classical, but then I am also going to be playing Western classical, some of the Hindustani ragas. We'll probably end with a lot of interactive popular music as well. So here goes. So I'll start with Ahir Bhairav.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, this is a quiz. Okay, so I'm going to play three songs which are from our own film traditions, which have to do with the moon. So all three, all moonathiyum, who says it first? Let me just see. Okay, so.
Thank you.
that was the first one. Yes, I know you all guessed the first one. The second one is... everything. The reason I played these three pieces is because all of them were sung by SPB, and I felt even though I'm mostly playing classical today, SPB ku or tribute pannalana should be good, because I know many of you have seen my work with him, and many of you have followed my interviews with him. I was very close to him, and I just thought that in this occasion, this is the first live performance for the season that I'm doing, so I thought I should do a little bit of a tribute for him. But I mean, all of these are moon related things. I don't know, the moon keeps inspiring everyone from classical music to Frank Sinatra, right? So you have thank you. I played a medley of different compositions. So one was Brohi Mukundeti. I played Giridhara Gopala, and then I played I mean, it's a combination, right? Ennathavam Seidhane. When we renovated and rededicated the piano that belonged to MS at Kalakshetra in 2006, Guru Charan and I got to do that concert. We did play most of these pieces on that occasion because it was the very piano that had been used by Shri Vaidyanathan to tune many of these compositions. On that note, I will play Hari Tumharo, which is in Darbari Kannada. It's a very evocative piece. I don't think I can ever do justice to somebody rendering it vocally as divinely as MS Amma, but I'm going to try and do it on the piano. Thank you. these pieces today, and the sequence in which I played it is that I started with Vivare Ramarasam, and I was playing Adharam Madhuram, the ragamalika, and I started with this whole idea of devotion and bhakti, but all of them coming out of the MS tradition, as I would like to call it, the MS Bani. But we sort of started going into how a lot of the music, a lot of it comes from Western music, the idea of tuning, composition, harmonization. And so I gave you examples from Western music, and these forms, Carnatic form and the Western form, have been talking with each other for a very long time. It's not just something that we are doing today. And how even today's film music is relying on those ideas, initial ideas in harmonization. I came back to Bruhi Mukundeti and Hari Tum Haro and Prabhuji Tere Bin, because it's all again part of the bhakti tradition, but really syncretic. The word syncretic meaning that it's pulling a lot of cultures together. It's not just coming out of one singular source. One of the things that MS I think was greatly known for is bringing songs from other languages into the Carnatic tradition, and Bengali being one of the most popular ones, because Tagore's compositions, etc., she popularized. We saw that Dikshitar brought in Western music from jigs, he's brought it into Carnatic. Let's look at how MS brought in some of these very beautiful pieces into the Carnatic tradition. And I'm going to play some more which she did not sing particularly, but are all related in the Tagore tradition. So these are all from the Rabindra Sangeet tradition from the east of India. I'm particularly playing five, it's again a medley of five beautiful Rabindra Sangeet compositions. Anandaloke, which of course MS has sung, Ekla Chalore, which I don't have to talk much about because it's very popular, Tumi Kemon Karo, Gaan Karo He Guni, and Amar Janmabhoomi.
Thank you.
course, Vivadi is a different concept. It's, I mean, the idea is that you are using notes which are alien to the scale and which are adjacent to one another to create a slightly dissonant effect. Whereas dissonance in the Western classical sense is a more studied sense of harmony. So one is a melody concept and one is a harmonic concept. But I have frequently applied the idea, so it's interesting that you ask that. So typically in a Western classical dissonance concept, you have things like this, and this comes in Debussy itself. So kind of things where it sounds odd, but it actually resolves to the tonic. So even when he does this, that's alien to the scale, and there's a dissonance there. And if I play a scale like Nasika Bhushani, for example, a very interesting idea to take. So when I play ragams like mand, I end up using a lot of dissonant harmonics, like in jazz. So when I do when I play those kinds of tilanas, I do stuff like, both in playing Vivadi ragams as well as in playing ragams like mand and tilang and things like that, I end up using a lot of dissonant harmony. The santur is the grandmother of the piano. So in Central Asia, and the harp together constitute the piano. The santurs is the exact direct line ancestor of the piano. So do I feel similar to it? Absolutely, because it is the exact same principle. In fact, with a little more enrichment, because we can also have the sustain enhanced because of the pedal. The santur and the harp. The harp comes also from South Asia, from Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia. And the santur from Central Asia and Northern India. And they both traveled through trade across Central Asia into Europe, got combined. As first the clavicle, the clavichord, the harpsichord, and then the piano. So the piano is actually sort of a great-great-grandchild of Indian instruments in a way. So yes, absolutely similar. That most of these pieces can be interpreted in very interesting, very varied ways. For example, when you mix it with the influence of the piano, or you put in Western music harmony, it still sounds beautiful, it sounds gorgeous. One such piece which I'm very fond of, which actually takes its inspiration from Western music directly, is Katrinile, Varum, Geetam. And I mean, it's immortal. And I'm going to play first the piece itself, but then I'm going to take you through a little journey into Western music and where it comes from. Okay. There were a couple of passages that I played deliberately more times than necessary. So, for example, here. So that's called a downward chromatic progression, and a very, very advanced kind of orchestration for the time in which that song came. But that idea itself comes from Western classical music. And this Katrinile Varum Geetam itself, as a melody, has a resemblance to a nocturne by Chopin, which itself in turn is inspired by a nocturne by a composer called John Field. So the reason that I played an extract of this is to actually show how a lot of this comes into the orchestration of some of these early songs. So things like, thank you. the second nocturne, which is ways and all this training in Western classical music has totally helped in orchestration, harmonization, and rendering Indian music in a slightly different way from what people are used to. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to play at least the first sections of each of these things in this concert and so forth. And that particular progression of this exactly the same in the John Field original. On that note, I thought I should play a little bit of Chopin. The idea of the nocturne, it's nighttime here in India, is very similar to the genre of music in which Poonkuyil and Katrinile, Varum, Geetam and all were composed, because these are all free-flowing, what we call salon pieces or entertainment pieces for a chamber music recital. And they don't have very fixed structure. They're almost like light music in their own way. But of course, on the piano, it's very complicated. Playing it is very complicated. I'm going to play one of the nocturnes, which is my favorite one. This is the first one in B flat minor, opus 9, number 1, by Frederic Chopin. One of the people that I wanted to also pay tribute to is the English notes of Muthuswami Dikshitar. Not much is spoken about it. I mean, it is sung by children and it's used in pedagogy, but they're beautiful compositions by themselves. There are totally about 30 plus, 31 or 32 of them. And I did a research study along with Professor Alberto Sana at the University of Liverpool about 5 years ago on the origins of these compositions. And you'd be surprised to know that many of them come from these Irish and Scottish jigs, you know, things that used to be sung in public houses and bars. And the English people, when they came, English, Scottish, Irish people who came as soldiers into Fort St. George under British occupation, they used to sing these things with drinks and things like that. And these started becoming popular for the bands in Fort St. George to play. And Dikshitar has taken it from that and then, you know, created an entire world of joy using that. I often tell people, if Dikshitar and people of that caliber did not find any distinctions between the different types of music, why should we? I mean, we should be able to support and appreciate anything and not have these strict categories. Those who are Carnatic music buffs, Parameshwari is just Nataka Priya but without the pa. So it's just basically, there's a famous Ilayaraja song which is in Nataka Priya, but it's got this Parameshwari vibe. Song, so next time you hear it, you think of Parameshwari.